Hello everyone. So today we'll be discussing some problems on binary search, and we will cover almost every variation which you may face in some of the problems, and like we will cover how to deal with binary search on floating point, and like we will also in whenever we are solving any problem, just try to observe like how to approach to any problem, because the biggest thing in binary search is like you need to find out whether the problem can be solved using binary search or not. So this is the biggest thing. So try to note it, ki how we are finding a problem is a problem, whether can it be solved using binary search or not. So we will be solving, we three will be solving about 5 to 6 problems today. So just try to follow along with us, and whatever questions we ask, try to answer it. Okay, so handing over to Vikram.
Hello. एक बार कोई बता दो, आवाज आ रही है नहीं आ रही?
हाँ, आ रही आ रही.
ठीक है. सो देयर्स जस्ट 15 गाइस राइट नाउ, सो कैन जस्ट वेट फॉर कपल ऑफ मिनट्स. ओके,
टिल देन जस्ट आई वांट टू से वन थिंग, की लाइक बाइनरी सर्च में देखो कोई भी क्वेश्चन मिलेगा ना, तो लाइक उसको ट्राई टू थिंक फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, मतलब कोई भी क्वेश्चन तुमको बोल के नहीं आएगा कि बाइनरी सर्च का क्वेश्चन है. जस्ट फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल फॉर एवरी क्वेश्चन, इफ यू आर नॉट एबल टू सॉल्व नॉर्मली, देन जस्ट तुम्हारे दिमाग में ये थॉट आना चाहिए कि मे बी दिस प्रॉब्लम कैन बी सॉल्व यूजिंग बाइनरी सर्च. तो फॉर दिस, मतलब कोई भी क्वेश्चन है, कोई भी कॉन्टेस्ट में दे रहे हो, वेन एवर यू आर सॉल्विंग अ प्रॉब्लम, इफ दैट क्वेश्चन कैन नॉट बी सॉल्व बाई एनी अदर मेथड, और इफ आर नॉट गेटिंग एनीथिंग इन माइंड, देन ऑलवेज थिंक ऑफ बाइनरी सर्च, कि वेदर दिस क्वेश्चन कैन बी सॉल्व यूजिंग बाइनरी सर्च और नॉट. And how will you find that? Just observe that, is there a monotonic function here, or can I form a monotonic function here? Monotonic, you all know, the function which is either non-increasing throughout, or it may be non-decreasing throughout. We had shown the graph in previous class, so how a monotonic function looks like. Like you solved a question in last class where an array of 0 and 1 was given, some a pattern like this 0, 0, 0, 0, then some 1, 1, 1, 1 like this. So after zeros only, all 1s are present. So it is a basically, you can say, non-decreasing function. So here in this type of question, if you need to find the last 0, first 0, so you can use binary search.
अच्छा, जब तक लोग ज्वाइन कर रहे हैं तो वैसे पूछ लेता हूँ, कोड सेफ पे मतलब कॉन्टेस्ट कौन कौन दे रहा है वैसे रेगुलरली? अब कोड फोर्सेस, कोड सेफ या कोडर पे चैट में लिखना एक बारी. ये दे रहे हो तो लिखो, यस. नहीं दे रहे तो नो लिख दो, कुछ तो लिखो.
सॉल्व नहीं कर पा रहे या कर पा रहे वो अलग बात है. इफ यू आर ट्राइंग देन जस्ट राइट यस.
मतलब कॉन्टेस्ट की स्क्रीन खोली, एटलीस्ट ए प्रॉब्लम देखा, सॉल्व किया, गलत सबमिशन भी आया हो कोई बात नहीं, बट दे रहा है एटलीस्ट कोई, मतलब ये पूछ रहा हूँ मैं. होना होना तो यार कुछ भी हो सकता है, कभी मेरा भी नहीं होता, चिल है वो तो.
एंड नॉट फॉर टुडे, इन जनरल वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट जनरली यू गिव और नॉट लाइक दिस.
हां यार, आज मेरे भी छूट गए, दो कॉन्टेस्ट थे आज, एक कोड शेफ पे था और एक हेडक्वार्टर पे था, दोनों छूट गए मेरे. ठीक है, अच्छा, आई थिंक सब दे रहे हैं. इट्स गुड, कॉन्टेस्ट बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है. ठीक है, कोड शेफ, ओके, राइट. So we'll just wait a couple of minutes more, okay, before starting. So not regular, okay. यार कॉन्टेस्ट दे सकते हो तुम लोग, पता है, मतलब रेगुलरली, क्योंकि कोड फोर्सेस के जितने भी कॉन्टेस्ट होते हैं सब रात के 8 बजे होते हैं, तो 8 बजे इज लाइक वेरी, मतलब बहुत कन्वीनियंट टाइम है, मतलब मेरे लिए तो बहुत कन्वीनियंट टाइम है, रात को कोई कुछ नहीं कर रहा होता, तो 2 घंटे निकाल के कॉन्टेस्ट तो दे ही सकते हो. ठीक है, और लॉन्ग किस किसने दिया था वैसे कोड शेप का? जिससे दिया था वो, जो जो भी लास्ट क्वेश्चन उन्होंने सॉल्व किया था उसका नाम लिखना एक बारी जरा, मतलब अगर किसी ने लॉन्ग दिया था तो जो लास्ट क्वेश्चन उन्होंने सॉल्व किया था कोड शेफ पे, नाम याद होगा तो. ओके, सो हुएवर गेव द लॉन्ग चैलेंज, राइट नाउ द क्लास इज नॉट स्टार्टेड, दैट्स व्हाई आई वाज टॉकिंग इन हिंदी, आई वाज जस्ट डिस्कसिंग जनरली. सो आई वाज जस्ट आस्किंग दैट whoever gave the Kutsef long challenge of February, just write the last question, the name of the last question that they solved. Rock salt. Okay, fine. Cool. ऑक्सफोर्ड, या ऑक्सफोर्ड इज गुड टीम नेम, गुड टीम नेम. ओके दैट्स गुड, आई रिमेम्बर दैट क्वेश्चन. राइट, सो आई गेस यू ऑल वर गिविंग डिवीजन 3, राइट, बिकॉज योर रेटिंग मस्ट नॉट बी दैट हाई राइट नाउ, सो यू जस्ट स्टार्ट, सो दैट्स गुड. Good team name was like, yeah. So, anyone else except for Saksham and Shank? Team name, but not completely. It's fine. Yeah. Okay, fine. Okay. Yes, I did three. Yeah, fine. So, it's good. Okay. And by the way, don't, you know, whenever you give the long challenge of course, okay, so don't take tension that people are solving 7 questions, 8 questions, okay. Basically why I asked this was because there was a lot of cheating in this February long challenge, okay. Like all the people who solved 7 questions and they, no, they didn't even know how to solve the 4th question. Like they copied the solution. So I was just, checking whether you solved it or not. So yes, I guess you all have solved it yourself only. So that's good. Okay.
Just adding to it, like one more thing I want to add. Some people feel that by cheating we will increase our rating, so it will be good. So, but don't feel like that. Don't think like that, because you must know that whenever you will give interviews for the companies, you need to just like in front of you are just given a whiteboard or a paper, you can say, and you need to solve the problem. You need to solve it by yourself. So you won't get help of anyone that time. So just prepare yourself for that. Means by cheating, you maybe that for some time you are able to increase the rating also, but it will not help in the long term. And also, like code chef also has plagiarism checker, so it will also check whether two course people are matching, so it will also decrease your rating after 1 month or something. So the rating will also not increase by that way. So just don't go for unfair means. Just I have to say this.
My checker bahut bekar hai bhai, unka kuch check nahi karta hu.
Maybe, but some of my friends, their code was detected, I think a few months ago. So I was just telling.
Okay. So basically the thing was, like, I was really frustrated at this long challenge. I actually gave it after, 6 months. So it was like, I solved 6.5 questions out of 9, okay, in division 2. So, just on the second last day, my rank was 80. Like, my global rank was 80 in division 2. And next day I opened the rating, the ranking, and I saw my rank go to 322 in just one day. And like, so that means a lot of people solved the 7th question last day. And that was not possible. So the 7th question was a good one. And even a lot of people in our college also cheated the second years. So I knew a couple of them, so I asked them, and they, they admitted that yes, sir, we cheated. So don't do that; it won't help you anything. It won't help you. So just maintaining a good rating adds to job. The thing is, you can write your rating in your CV, but that does not affect that much. That does not play a role in that. Right? Basically, whatever. But I have even heard that, like, if you have a a great rating, they may ask you more tough questions. Like, this can also happen. Like, I don't know. I heard it somewhere. So that can backfire as well.
Okay, so I think many people have now joined, so we can start now.
Okay, so if you're giving contest, so I'll just take a question from a recent contest of Bandy Search. Okay. Just wait a second. Okay, so yeah, this was one. Yeah. So who gave this contest? Like, division 2, 703. वॉज देयर एनी वन गिव दिस कॉन्टेस्ट हु ट्राई टू सॉल्व द सी वन क्वेश्चन ऑफ दिस. इट्स अ गुड क्वेश्चन. There, even okay, fine. So, just let me post the question in the link in the chat box. So, I've pasted the question in the chat box. You can go through it, and I'll just explain what an interactive problem is. Okay, I think. That's the first time you're hearing this. So basically, an interactive problems are those problems in which your input is not predefined. Okay. In normal questions, what you have is like you first take the input and then you print the output. So in these questions, in interactive problem, what happens is that you'll take input and output simultaneously. Like suppose in this question, there's an what the hell happened? Yeah. So I'll just copy. Fine. So in this question, there's an array A of n different numbers, okay? And you don't know the array. You don't know which element of the array is what, okay? There's an array, okay, of n numbers. So in one query, so we define query as you can ask the position of the second maximum element in a subsegment ALR. So basically the thing, basically what the problem is that there is an array of n numbers and let's say I am the judge and you are trying to solve the question. Okay. So I know the array A and you don't know it. Okay. So you can ask me one query that tell me the position of the second maximum element in the subsegment ALR. So let's say you give me two numbers L and R. So I will return you the index of the second maximum element in that subsegment. Okay. So this is one query. You define this as query. So you need to find the maximum. So you need to find the position of the maximum element present in the array. Okay. So we'll just give you an example. So let's say the array is 5, 1, 4, 2, 3. Okay. So let's say this is the array. I know this array. You don't know the array. So this is the array and I know this array. But you are solving the question, you don't know it. Let's suppose I am the judge. Okay. So let's say you give me L as 1 and R as 5. So basically, it's the first index, it's one base indexing. Okay. So this is the first. So I will give you the index of the second maximum element present in the array. So the second maximum element is 4. So I'll give you 3. Okay. So please increase the font size. Okay. So let's say you give me L and R as 1 and 5. So I will return you 3. So you now know that the second maximum element present in the array is 4. Let's say you give me L as 3 and R as 5. Okay. So L is 3. So that means, and R is 5. That means this is your subsegment. So the second maximum element here is 3 and its index is 5. So I'll return you 5. Okay. So you can ask me 40 queries like this in the question it is given. So you can ask 40 queries like this. Let's suppose I am the judge and you are the one who is solving the question. You can ask me 40 queries that, okay, give me the second maximum element between these, between this range. 40 times, not more than 40 times. You can use less number, but not more than 40. Okay. So, and you need to find the position of the maximum element. ओके सो यू नीड टू फाइंड द पोजिशन ऑफ द मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट इन द होल एरे. सो इज द क्वेश्चन क्लियर? लाइक वट इज द क्वेश्चन? नाउ आई विल एक्सप्लेन टू यू हाउ टू टेक इनपुट एंड आउटपुट इन एन इंटरेक्टिव इंटरेक्टिव प्रॉब्लम. Is the question clear that what you need to do and what you can do in this, like what you have to find the maximum index and you can just ask these queries. You can only ask these queries and you don't know anything about the array except the size of the array. Just write yes or no. Yes, sir. Okay. What about others? Yes, no, can write at least. Yeah, fine. So this is the question. Now I'll tell you how to take input in this. So basically in an interactive problem there are two people. So one is the judge and one is the, like, you can say solver, like problem solver, I can say. So you can say you, like, okay, like one is you and one is the judge. So judge, so basically just wait a second. So judge basically knows the array and you don't know anything about the array. So you don't know anything about the array and you need to find the maximum position of the index of the maximum element. Okay, so basically you can output, so basically you will ask the judge. So for asking, what you will do is you will, it's mentioned in the question, is something wrong with this question? Problem statement changes. So you can ask queries by printing this. Okay, so you can do something like this, L R. Okay, so you can do this operation. You can print question mark L and R. So this, what this means is that I need, that you are asking the judge about the second maximum element in the subsegment from L to R. So this is what you can do. Okay, and in response to this, the judge will give you the index of the second maximum element. So let's say you have a variable x, so you will store it in x. So whatever you ask the judge, you see out that, okay, and whatever the judge gives you back, that's the input in this question. So this is how you do it. So just think about the approach. Okay, just if you give me the approach right, then that's good. Don't bother much about the, you know, input and output. When we go through the code, you will understand how to code an interactive problem. So just try to think about how you can solve this question. Just try to develop the logic. So you can't do like you just have 40 queries. So think about this. And the size of n is also given as n is, let's say, so is n is from 2 to 10 raised to power 5. So these are the constraints. So just try to think about the logic. I'm giving you a couple of minutes. So I'll just walk through this code, just this example. Okay, so first the input, first line is the input n. Okay, so initially, so first it would be the input n. So that means that is the size of the n. You are asking the size of the array. You can assume it to be like, you can think of it like this. Okay, then you can ask queries. Now you can see that here there is space. So here's, so in place of this space you have this query. Basically you are asking this query. So let's say you do something like this. Okay, सो नाउ द जज विल रिटर्न यू बैक. सो सो हियर आई एम अज्यूमिंग द एरे टू बी दिस. ओके सो अज्यूम द एरे टू बी दिस. So if you do CNX here, as you have printed, just let me do 1 and 5. Okay. So you're doing, so X here would be 3. So X is basically the index of 4. Next, you can see that you have 3 now. Now next you are taking the input as 4, 5. So you are writing something like 4, 5. Next, you will again take the input. So here, X now becomes X now becomes 4. Okay, so you can see 4 here because from the subsegment 4, 5. The subsegment 4, 5 has 2 elements, 2, 3, and 2 is the second maximum element. So the index is 4, so we are getting 4 here. So this is how you do it. And whenever you have got the answer, now that I know that this is the index of the maximum element, you just need to print something like answer. Like suppose there is a variable, you find answer somehow. So just output the answer in there, and this is the symbol you need to use to output the answer. This is specified in the question. So this is the question. This is how you take input output in an interactive problem. I'm not asking you to code it. You may not be able to code an interactive problem at first go, but I'm just asking you logic, like how can you find the maximum element, the index of the maximum element. Just think about it. So if we ask 4, 4, will it give 4th element? No. The thing is, Saksham, it is mentioned that R is greater than L. It cannot be equal. So basically, it will give you an error. So R is always greater than L. So no, that's not possible. The subsegment should be of at least 2 size. Okay.
If anyone has not understood the question, then you can ask in the chat. Or if you have understood, then just try to think of any logic, and whatever your logic you get, just try to write in the chat.
First, find the second max of the whole array. Then reduce the sample space to half using binary search to say which half has higher second max number. Okay. So just let me think. So I think you're saying that in whichever half the second maximum element you get. I mean, let's say here we're saying that you have the, so you find the mids, 1 plus 5 mid, so mid becomes 3, and say the second maximum element, let's say you're dividing the array into 2 parts from 1 to mid and mid plus 1 to n, so this, and you find the second maximum element of whole array, so you get the index as 3. So in whichever part 3 that index is, you go to that part. Is that what you're saying, man? First ask L equal to 1, R equal to L, then low equal to high, then use binary search and keep updating the maximum value form. Yes, but now I feel it's incorrect. Yeah, it's good that you figured it out yourself. Srizi, can you explain what you're trying to say using the example? Couldn't get you. Keep updating the maximum value call. For L is equal to 1, R is equal to 1, to get position of second maximum element, then take L and N equal to R, see if input is coming same as the previous one, the maximum. First, L is 1, R is T, R is N, to get position of second maximum element. Then take that L, okay, and N equal to R. N equal to R, like, think you've mixed up something, like, hush. Just try to write it clearly. Sir, if we find L to R in which two. In which who is higher, then it will be 1 and remaining will 0. If you find L to R in which is higher, then it our second largest element of array and second largest element of low to mid. If both are same, then repeat process in the first half, else repeat. Yes, that's correct. So Rogers, whoever it is, that's the correct solution, right? So can you tell the input format again? Okay, so input format is first, and the first line is your n, which you're inputting n, so that is the size of the array. And then if you want the second maximum element between some segment L and R, let's say you have some L as 1, R as 5, let's say. So you'll just have to print something like this, and in return the judge will give you an input. So this is, so judge will return this, okay? So X will get X as 3. Next, if you write 4, 5, and you take input again, so X would be 5, 4 here. So this is how you take input.
Just one thing you need to remember is ki in interactive problem, whenever you are printing something, whenever you are using cout, just use END and endl, or use either you can use flush also. Means this will actually just flush your buffer. Means you don't need to understand what it is doing, but you need to use endl whenever you use cout.
Don't use slash n, okay, in an interactive problem, because the thing is, when it, let's if you have solved questions on code forces and you have used endl and slash n, you will see the difference. Like when you use endl, after each test case it will print the output, but if you use slash n, then it will take the entire input and then print all the outputs simultaneously in the last. So that's the difference. So in this case, every time just remember this, that you have to use endl. So I think I got one correct solution. Rogers' idea is correct. So let's say I'm considering the array from 1 to n. Okay, fine. So let's say you get the second maximum element from 1 to n. Okay, so you get something as, let's call it z, that the out you ask the judge about, you ask the query 1 to n, and the judge returns you z. So z is an index. Now let's say your mid is n plus 1 by 2, fine. Now let's look at, okay, just let me think. A1, A2. Okay, fine. So basically, this is how I thought about this question when I was attempting it in the contest. So let's take four numbers. Okay, just writing this for explanation. Okay, so A1, so basically A1 is the maximum element in the array. A2 is the second maximum, A3 is the third maximum, and A4 is the fourth maximum. Basically, I'm considering four numbers. So the cases can be that A1, A2 are in the same array, in this and let's divide the array two parts, like one to mid. This is one part and mid plus one to n. Let's divide this in the array. So there can be two cases. This that either a1, a2 are in the same array, or a2 and a3, a4 are in different array, are in the other part. Similarly, you can have a1, a3, and a2, a4. Okay. And let's say a1, a4. Okay. A3. So now you know the position of this A2. You know the position of A2. Okay. So whichever side A2 is, okay, let's consider this case. Let's say that A2 is in first half. That is 1 to mid. Okay. So let's consider that A2 is in this half. So now if you apply, now you'll just apply the query 1 to mid. So can you, so consider like this is the case. So can you tell me the value of 1 to mid? That what the judge will return in this case, in the first case I'm talking, a1, a2 are in the same half and a3, a4 are in different half. Can you tell me the value of 1 to mid? It would be a2. I think you need to say z, because z is what we have defined a2. So yeah, basically you're correct. So it would give you the index of a2, so that would be z again. Right. So let's call it x for now. Okay. So in this case, you get x. So that, so, and can you tell me in this case? Okay, I'll just swap it. Let's say your a2, a4 are in the first half and a1, a3 are in the second half. So let's say, so whose position will it return? Now, before, yeah, so basically it won't be equal to a2. And by the way, it's given that all the numbers are different, array n of n different numbers, right? So in this case, whatever you will return, it would be not be equal to z, not equal to z. In this case, it would be equal to z. And similarly, can you tell for this case? A4. No, actually, consider this part. And just let me swap it. Yeah, now just consider, I'm considering the part which has two a2 in it. A3, yeah. So in this case, it again won't be equal to z. Right. So you can see that now you have taken care of all the cases. You can see that if the answer to this query and to this query, if they are same, okay, they are equal to z, then you have a1 in the same half as a2, and you know the half of a2, you know the index of, so basically you know the half in which a1 is present, and you can ignore the other half. So basically in this case, you'll ignore the second half. एंड इन दिस केस सेकेंड केस इट वॉज नॉट इक्वल टू ए टू दैट मीन्स इन दिस इन दैट एर इन दैट पार्ट ए टू हैज बिकम द मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट सो दैट इम्प्लाइज दैट ए वन मस्ट हैव बीन इन द अदर हाफ सो यू गो टू द अपर हाफ सिमिलरली इन दिस केस यू नो दैट ए टू हैज बिकम द मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट सो ए वन मस्ट हैव बीन इन द अदर हाफ सो so this is how you apply binary search like you are halving the array so is this clear like the approach clear I'll code it now don't worry about that just understand that how you are halving the array at each step like how you're deciding whether to go left or to go right that's the most important that's the only important thing yeah fine So, by the way, how I thought that this question about binary search was that you're given 40 queries, okay? And if you multiply, let's say, so basically, if you multiply 2, like if you consider log n, so that is roughly around 15 or 17 something, okay? So in this code at each query you're doing at each iteration like for each value of l comma r you are using query two times like one from 1 to n and one from 1 to mid 1 to mid or mid plus 1 to r depending on in which half a2 is present so this if you multiply it into 2 so that would be less than equal to 40 like something like this into 2 so that would be less than equal to 40 so this is how I thought about it that okay you know binary login and at each iteration you need to you can perform two queries so this is how I thought that binary search can be applied in this question okay so constraints many times tell you how to approach the question okay so let's code it So first line is the and by the way when you move left or right you just have to recursively apply the same logic to that array to that sub array like gone left right if you have gone left you just need to apply the same thing from 1 to mid and if you're going right you just need to apply the same logic to mid plus 1 to r so let's code it so first we take the input
I'm just increase the font size a bit in this case okay yes fine
So first line is the input n. So I'll just and now let's define as l as 1, r as n. Okay. So basically, this initially you are considering the whole array. Now, can anyone tell what can be the condition here in while loop? Anyone? Okay, I'll come to the condition later. Okay, fine. So first you find mid. Okay, and then first you will store z. So z is I'll make a function query. Okay, r minus l greater than 1. So yeah, that's correct. So I'll explain it later. Okay. Just let me write the code which I have already explained. So query would be L to R. So and now you just need to see if Z is present from L to mid or from mid plus 1 to R. So let's say if Z is less than equal to mid. So this case is that a2 is present in the first half okay so that means you need to consider x as we need to find the answer from L to B. Okay, and if your x is z, so that means a1 and a2 are in the same half, and a2 was less, and a2 is present in the first half, so we go right, left. Okay, else we go right. So this is a1 and a2 present in L to mid, so that means go left. Similarly here, a1 and a2 present in different halves. So a1, and now we know that a2 was present in the first half because this is the condition we initially applied. So here we go right, and else, so this is the case that a2 is present in second half. So you can say mid plus 1 R, something like this. Okay. So you can do again x as query mid. By the way, I'm taking mid here, okay, because let's say your the subsegment L comma R is of 3 size. So if it is of size 3, so mid would be your second element, and if you do mid plus 1, so it would be equal to R. So in that case, mid and R, mid plus 1 and R would become same. So that is not a valid query. So that's why I'm taking it from mid to R, so it won't affect the answer. Okay, so if x is your z again, so that means a1 and a2 present in same half, so that is mid to R. So you have to go right. So right means L is mid. So and else you have to go in the opposite side, and this is like a1 and a2 present in different half, so go L to mid. So this is the now I'll make the condition here as mine minus L greater than 1. So that means the subsegment L comma R should be at least of size 3. Okay. So greater than 1 means that R minus L can be minimum 2. So if it is minimum 2, so you can say that, let's say your L is 1 and R is, let's say, 3. So in this case, the subsegment is of 3 size. Like there are 3 elements present, and R minus L is 2. So R minus L should be greater than 1. Okay. So when you come out of this loop, okay, so you will have a subsegment of 2 size. Like L and R would be consecutive. Let's say L is 1 and R would be your 2. If L was 4, then R would be your 5. So you need to apply the query again from L to R. And can you tell me these cases, that what would be the output here and what would be the output in the else part? Like if Z is equal to L, then what you need to print, and if it is not, then when you what you need to print. Can you tell me the answer in both the cases in one comment, like separated by comma? एनीवन आर एल या दैट्स करेक्ट. सो यू हैव टू एलिमेंट्स नाउ एल एंड एल प्लस वन. लेट्स इन नाउ योर आर इज यू कैन अज्यूम टू बी एल प्लस वन. सो यू हैव टू एलिमेंट्स. सो एंड यू फाइंड द सेकेंड मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट. सो इफ योर सेकेंड मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट इज एल दैट मीन्स योर मैक्सिमम एलिमेंट शुड बी आर. सो यू कैन प्रिंट लाइक आर आर हियर एंड यू कैन प्रिंट एल्स इट वुड बी L here, and I'll just make the query function here. So what you do in query is you print question mark L R, okay, N Z C N Z. So and you're returning it. So this is the code. Let's run it. Let's say your n was 5 and I'll assume the array to be same as let's assume the array to be 5 1 4 2 3. So this is the array. So if I ask for 1 to 5, the judge will give me 3 back. So 3. Then I ask from 1 to 3. So 1, 2, 3. The second max element is 4. So I will again give 3. So I will ask 1 to 3 again. So that will give me 3 again. So I'll ask from 2 to 3. So that will give me 2. So I'll ask again from 1 to 2, so that would give me 2. So my final answer is 1. By the way, you can do one more thing here. You can optimize it further. You can let's say that you can, you as you saw in the previous example, I asked the same query twice. Like I asked 1 to 3 twice. So instead of doing it twice, you can use a map of so pair. So PIA is basically pair. I have defined it as has defined pair. Okay, so I've defined, so that's pair, mapping a pair to an int. So before printing the query, if we have already, if it is already you know, we have already asked the query is not equal to m dot n. So in that case, we can return m of mp is basically make pair. I have defined it above as defined mp as make pair. So okay, and l comma r. Otherwise, you will print that. So before returning, you just do make pair l comma r is set. So now you can, if you run it now, you will see that 1 comma 3 would only be inputted once. So let's say 5 plus 3, once 3 was 3. So now you have 2, 3. 1, 3 has gone. So you do 2. So 1, 2, 1, 2 will give you 2. So answer is 1. So this is how you do it. Just let me submit it once to confirm it. Yeah, got accepted. It's fine. So, is this clear? Does anyone have any doubt in this? You can ask. Just print the code. Doesn't even have any doubt. That interest, but the pair is doing okay. So rest part is clear, man. The logic is clear. You just didn't understand that what this map is doing, right? Okay, fine. So what this map is doing is, if we have calculated the answer for some query, let's say L comma R, if we know the answer to L comma R already, then we are, then instead of asking the same query again, like if we ask it again, so then that means, you know, it's wasting our queries. Like we have just 40 queries, so that's wasting our queries basically. So instead of asking it again, I'm storing it in a map. Like I'm storing the answer here for L comma R in a map. So if that entry, that L comma R, is already present in that map, so that means we have already asked this query. So that means then why should we ask it again? So in that case, we're simply returning the answer which was found earlier. So this is what the map is doing. It's basically removing the redundant queries, like the same query. So is it okay?
You can also try to submit without map. I think it should get accepted.
Yeah, it would work. Because for each iteration, you are doing query two times. Like one is here and one is here. Like if this runs, this won't run. So basically two times per iteration. So, and number of iterations can be at max 15 to 17. So it would still run if you don't use a map, but this was more optimized. So, by the way, this is the C1 part. I took the C1 part because it was easier for you to understand. Try the C2 part as well. It's a good question. In that, instead of 40, you can just use 20 queries. So try to optimize it. The answer would be the same code with some minor changes. Okay. So does anyone have any doubt, or is it clear? Right, yes or no? What about others? How will we get redundant queries? Okay. So, let's see.
Yeah, in this, I think there would not be redundant queries because we are searching.
Hi, guys. Let's say this was the initial array, okay? So I'll explain it here. Okay. So initially you will ask for 1 to 5, okay? Because L is 1 and R is your 5. So you will get the answer as 3. So this is your 3. Now it will enter this because Z is less than or equal to mid. Mid in this case is, mid is 3. Mid is 3. So it will enter this if loop, okay? So here, if you will ask the query for L to mid, so L was 1 and mid was your 3, so we'll ask for 1, 3, so it will give you 3 again, because 3 was because 5, 1, 4, second maximum element is 4, so it will give you 3. So if x is equal to z, yes, it is. This was Z. This was Z. This was your X. So yes, they are equal. So R becomes your mid. Mid was 3. So R has become 3. So now L is 1. R is 3. So now when you do it again, next iteration, you will have Z as query L comma R. So L comma R is 1. So L is 1 and 3, so you'll get the same query as again, 1, 3. So you're getting the same query here, and you're getting the same query here. So instead of asking it again, I'm storing it in a map. So this is how you get redundant queries, like the same query repeating. It won't be much, like You will st if you don't use a map, you'll still get a correct answer.
Achha, someone has asked that he understood the logic, but just he did not get the code. So I think just explain him like what that while loop part inside that what we are doing just once.
Which part you did not understand, Mayank? Can you specify?
Quantum states here. They are playing quantum states.
Man, just specify which part you didn't understand, and if any other one has any doubt, then you can. So it's still getting confused in the conditions in the while. Okay. So basically, what we're checking using this if else is the outer if else is that. In which part A2 is present, like which A2 is, I defined A2 as the second maximum element present in L, R. So basically using this if else, the this if and this else, we are checking that in which part, like we have divided the array in two parts, like one to mid and mid to L, R. So we are just checking if in which part A2 is present. Okay, so if it is this, so that means if z is less than equal to mid, the index you got from L comma R is less than mid. So that means A2 is present in the first half from L to mid. So in that case, you will ask a query from L to mid. I think the logic was would be clear that why we are asking. So basically, we need to ask the second query for the part in which A2 is present. Like we have divided the array in two parts. So we need to ask the second query in the part A2 is present. So using this if else, we are just checking that. So if it is present in the first half, we'll take the query from for the first half again. And if it is not present in the first half, that means present in the second half. So that's, that means we'll take the query for the second half. And then we'll compare with Z. This is what we're doing. So, man, is it okay now? Yes, okay. Oh, anyone else has any other doubt? Just write yes or no. So, three or four students are responding. What about others? Just try to quote this yourself. Okay. Now Rajan will continue.
Hello, Vikram.
Hi, bhai.
Vikram.
Hi.
So, have you discussed the problem? Discuss कर दिया है.
हाँ कर दिया.
ठीक है. तो मैं अब स्क्रीन शेयर करता हूँ.
हाँ मैं बंद कर रहा हूँ.
Hello. So my screen is visible or not? Hello. So anybody?
Yes, it is visible. Visible, visible.
Write on a chat box. Okay. So this is a problem. So I'm going to share the link of the problem. So this is the problem on Netcoder. So just read it once, and then we will discuss it. Okay. So after reading the problem, just tell me. What first comes into your mind, like the problem is of a simple array problem or a binary search problem or any kind of, I mean, what intuition that comes into your mind first after reading this problem, just tell me, because that's very important part, you know, before solving the problem, that whether you're going in a correct direction or not. Okay, so let me read the problem statement. So basically you have n logs. So logs are basically a stick, you know, you can treat it like a stick. So you have n sticks of length a1, a2, a3, dot, 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 an. Okay, and we can cut these logs at most k number of times. Okay, so you have n number of sticks, you may cut at most k number of times. Okay, and when a log of length l is cut at a point whose distance from an index t, then it become two logs of length t and l minus 2. Then find the shortest length of longest log after at most k cuts and print. Okay, so I will show with the dashboard, so it will be easy for you to understand. So basically you will be given n logs. So logs are basically sticks. So let's say one stick, two sticks, three sticks, four sticks, five, and up to n number of sticks. Okay, so let's say the length of your first stick is l1. So let's say the length of your first stick is a1, second stick is a2, third stick is a3, fourth is a4 and a5, and similarly a of n. Okay, so these are basically the length of your sticks, any particular sticks. Okay, and one more thing, it is given that you cut these sticks at most k number of times. Okay, and one more point is that if you cut any particular sticks of length t, for example, so this would become t and this would become a of 1 minus t. Okay, a of 1 minus t. Okay, so now after cutting this stick, now it would come into two number of sticks. So this is your first stick, this is your second stick. So the length of this stick would be a t and the length of this stick would be a minus t. Okay. So what you have to find here, you have to find the shortest possible length of the longest. I mean, for let's say after cutting the first stick into two parts of length t and a minus t, let's say your max value. So basically your max length would be max of a of I. I mean a of I. So basically you have to find out the max value among all these sticks, t, a minus t, a2, a3, a4, a5, a7, an. So the maximum would be, now you have to minimize this value. I mean the maximum length of any sticks, for this number you have to minimize. Okay, so let me show with an example so it will be easy for you. So let's say you have two sticks of length 7 and 9. Okay, 7 and 9. Okay, so if you don't cut at all, so the maximum value would be 9. And if you cut this second stick into two parts, let's say 5 and 4, so now you have three sticks, 7 of 7 length, 5 length and 4 length. Okay, and 4 length, and now the max value would be, it becomes 7. So you have to minimize this number. I mean, so if you don't cut at all, so the maximum would be 9. If you cut once, then the number becomes 7. So now the number is minimized. So you have to minimize this number, and you have to tell basically that what is the minimum possible value after cutting at most k number of times. So I guess the problem is clear to all of you. So if not, then just write on a chat box. I will explain it once again. So basically you will be given n number of sticks and you may cut at most k number of cuts, and after cutting so you have to tell the maximum value that should be minimum possible. Okay, so basically first of all tell me that you understand the problem or not. I mean, that's the important part, that whether you understand the problem correctly or not. Can anybody write? I mean, yes sir, only one student. Should I explain it again in different manner? I mean, if you didn't get it. Yes sir. Okay, so those who got the problem correctly, then just think about the solution. Just take 5 minutes or 2 or 3 minutes and just think about the solution. And those who didn't understand, I will explain it once again. So I have a couple of minutes, so you know I have nothing to do, so I will explain it once again, those who didn't understand, and those who got the problem correctly, then just you know, think about the solution. Okay, so basically you will be given n number of sticks, A1. Okay, the length could be different as well, dot 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 this. Okay, so the length are given as A1, A2, A3, A3, A4, dot 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 similarly. Okay, so let's say if the maximum value, for example, let's say A of I, so this is your maximum value among all these lengths. Okay, so if you don't cut it, so if you don't cut any of the sticks, so your max value would become will be AI itself. Okay, so if you cut any of the sticks, so let's say this is your maximum sticks, the length of maximum stick, that is A4. Okay, so if you cut it in a two part, so the length would become, so let's say I have cut it into two parts of length L, so this length would be A4 minus L. Okay, so now your maximum value has been reduced. I mean, initially your maximum length was A of 4, basically A of 4. So if you cut into two parts, so now the length would become L and A of 4 minus L. So now, so basically you have to minimize this max value. So now again calculate maximum possible length after cutting it, I mean A1, A2, A3 and these two parts, and then A5, A6, A7, all these. Just find the maximum value, and that number should be minimized. I mean, you have to minimize that particular number, that max value. I guess the problem is clear to all of you. I mean, because the problem statement is very short, I mean.
Okay, Saksham Divedi. Sir, apply, sir, binary search and with each mid value, just check the number of cuts being made for achieving that length. If the cuts is less than K, then just increase the length of cut, okay. It's correct, absolutely correct. Mayank Narayan, we can keep cutting the largest stick at each moment of half.
Okay, so, but you know, the problem in your solution is that, Mayank Narayan, your intuition is basically correct, but how will you prove that it will always give you the optimal answer? I mean, if you somehow able to prove that it will give always optimal answer, then it's fine, I mean. But you have to prove it, Mayank Narayan. But your intuition is basically absolutely correct. Okay. Okay. So, yeah.
Rajendra, so, one thing I want to say, like, in this whiteboard, you do not need to erase the previous thing. You can just scroll down, so it will be automatically erased. Like, you can scroll below.
Okay. Because I'm using it for the first time. That's why I don't know. Okay. So let's say, so let's see with an example. So 3, 4, and 5. So you have three sticks of length 3, 4, and 5. Okay, 5. And in the second test kit, it is given that the at most, I mean, the value of K is 0. I mean, you can't cut a stick. So your maximum value would be 5. So see, the answer is 5. Now look at the first example. So your first example was 7. So the length of first stick was 7 and your length of second stick was 9. Okay. And you can cut at most 3 number of times. So if you don't cut it at all, so if you don't cut it, your maximum value would be 9. If you cut it for a first time, let's say I have cut it in a two parts. Let's assume that my first part is 4 and second part is 5. So now the maximum value would be among 7, 4 and 5. So now your maximum value has been reduced to 7. So see, after cutting one part, your number is reducing. Again, it will cut. So just again cut into let's say 3 and 4. So again, so now your number is maximum of 3, 4, 4 and 5. So again, the number of the maximum value would be 5. So see, if you cut each times, your maximum value is going to reduce. So just see the monotonic behavior here. Like, so let me draw again. So, okay. So if this is the graph, and if this, my y-axis representing the max value, and your x-axis is representing number of cuts. Okay. So if you don't cut it at all, then your value would be maximum of all the lengths. Okay. If you cut it for the first time, then your maximum value would be reduced. Again, if you increase the number of cuts, so your maximum length would reduce always. I mean, because it is always optimal to, you know, to cut the stick of maximum length. Okay, so your maximum value is always going to reduce. So see, the behavior is always a monotonic, and I think Chirag might have told you the monotonic behavior of binary search, like when to apply binary search basically. So this is the behavior of monotonic. So you may apply binary search here. So this is the intuition behind the problem. I mean, how to apply binary search and why to apply binary search basically. I mean, there are so many methods to solve the problem, but why to apply binary search? So this is the reason behind, you know, using binary search, because of the behavior of the problem. So the behavior of the problem is a monotonic behavior. So you may apply binary search here. I guess the intuition is clear to all of you. I mean, what is the approach basically? So is it clear or not? I mean, the behavior, like how it is showing monotonic behavior. So we can keep cutting the largest stick at this moment of half. Yeah, Mayank Naran, you are correct, but it will not always give the optimal answer. By the way, I don't have any example, otherwise I would have shown you.
Sir, will the output involve set precision?
No, your output would always be an integer value, because it is given that the round up to an integer. So you don't have to look at the, you know, real values, floating point number, just put the integer value.
Anand, we will do binary search on max possible length. If it can be cut with that length, then the largest bigger length.
Anand, your intuition is correct, but your solution is not correct. I mean, by the way, is it clear? I mean, the approach is clear or not? Nobody write on a chat box. I mean, why you guys are not interacting today? I mean, okay, because the next part is to just code it. So if you didn't get the approach, then just let me know. I will explain it once again. Otherwise, I am going to, you know, write the code for this problem.
Clear, sir. Mayank Naren, clear, sir.
Okay. So those who understand till now, just tell me what would be your search space. I mean, you are going to apply the binary search on which part? I mean, you know, there are something which, because we are going to binary search apply on which thing. I mean, my question is that you understand that the problem can be solved using binary search. So what would be your search space? Just tell me what is your search space. You know, in binary search, you write low and high, then you calculate mid value. But what is the search space basically? Anybody knows?
So Saksham, Priyanka, clear, sir. Okay.
So the problem is clear to all of you, and I think solution is also clear. So the next part is to just code it. Okay. So anybody didn't tell me, like, what would be your search space?
Length of log maybe. Okay, so you are in doubt for the minimum length of log. Okay, yeah, sir, does head has to be new. Why not cutting the log of length 9 if it is the highest into half 4 and 5? And does has to be an integer, why not cutting the log?
Okay, so basically, so it is given that you have to find the answer in terms of integer. So always, you know, if your length is basically 4, so let's say if your length is 8, so just cut it into two parts, I mean length of 4 and 4. If you're doing the half cutting method, which is not correct basically, okay, and but if you have an odd length, like let's say 9, so just cut into two parts, 4 and 5. Okay, but this is not correct basically, that, you know, it looks like that always cut the maximum length into half, but it is not always gives the optimal answer. You have to prove it. Okay, yeah, so basically your search space would be your length. Okay, so I think I should code it now. Okay, so just wait a minute. Okay, so your input format is basically you have to kind of first off you have to take the input n and k and then an array. Okay, so just take input n, so let me increase the font, and n comma k, n k, then create a vector of n of size n. Then for int I equals to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, c in a of I. Okay, so just tell me, if k equals to 0, then what would be your answer? If k equals to 0, then what would be your answer? Anybody write on a chat box. If your k value is 0, then what will be your output? Hello. I guess I am audible. Yeah, so if you are not allowed to cut any of the sticks, so your answer would be maximum value. So see, in a second example, you are not allowed to cut any of the sticks, so your maximum value would be 5. Yeah, so basically this is not needed here, I just wanted to ask you. So your search space would be your length. So let's assume that your minimum length possible is 0. So basically 0 is not possible. So your maximum length possible is 1, and your max length possible is, let's assume that 1 in 9. It doesn't matter basically. And so this is basically your search space. So let me comment here. Your search space is basically length of max stick. Okay. Okay. So just apply the standard binary search. While low is less than or equal, so this would be basically high. Yeah, by the way, it doesn't matter. It's just a variable name. So, okay, just create a mid value. Int mid equal to low plus high minus low divided by 2. If so, let's create a helper function. Okay, if okay mid, I mean, if this is possible to take this particular maximum length, then just low your, so then let's create one another variable, that is answer, int answer, answer, so initially equal minus 1. So answer is equals to mid, low equals to mid plus 1, else r is equal to mid minus 1, we'll see out answer. So basically what I'm doing here, so I have shown you the monotonic behavior. So let's assume that, so initially I assume that my maximum, my length initially was 0. So my low value was 1, and my high value was my 10 to the power 9. Okay, 10 to the power 9. So basically what I did here, I calculated mid value. I calculated mid value. So let's assume that this is your mid. Okay, this is your mid. And to find this maximum value, so let's assume that the number of cuts are less than or equals to k. If the number of cuts required to you know, to get the maximum value as a mid, if this is less than or equal to k, so it is always possible to, you know, to get the higher value. I mean, let's see with this example. So let's say if your maximum value is, I mean, if 4 is possible, your maximum value, so 5 is also possible, because the number of cut that would be required to take the higher value would always be less than k. So let's say if 4 required 5 number of cuts, so all the lengths which are greater than 4, that would require always less than or equal to 5 number of cuts, because my maximum length is, you know, that is more than my previous length. I think this is clear. So if this is possible, so I just high equals to mid minus 1, otherwise low equals to mid plus 1. So did you understand that or not? I mean, what I'm doing here. So basically what I'm trying to say here is that if
let's use this fourth option for scrolling. This fourth option, you can see in the tool, that one can be used for scrolling down in the whiteboard. I'm telling.
Okay, where?
From the left, where this pencil option is there now. Top right.
Yeah.
Yes. For scrolling down, so that you do not need to erase this.
Okay.
Just drag it below, and it will scroll down.
Fine. Okay. So basically, what I'm trying to say here is that, so these are basically your sum parts. Okay. These are your sticks, and so I have calculated my mid value. So right now I am trying to check how many cuts would be required to get this maximum length. So let's assume that the length for the number of cuts which is required to get this maximum value was, let's say, x. Okay, so just tell me all the lengths which are greater than this mid value, the number of cuts that is required would be either greater than x or less than x or equals to x. Just tell me among these three options, if the maximum value for calculating the mid value, the number of cuts, if the number of cuts required is x, so all the length which are greater than mid, so the number of cuts that would be required would be either more than x or less than x or equals to x. Just write on a chat box. Less. Okay, yeah, Mayank Nadi, you are correct, and that's the reason why I'm doing here. I mean if it is possible to take this maximum value, so it is always possible to take higher values. So just decrement your right boundary. So basically, if this is your left boundary, if this is your L, this is your R. So if this is your left boundary and this is your right boundary, I have calculated mid value. So if it is, so if we can take this maximum value, so it is always possible to take this value. So just decrement your right boundary. So now your boundary become this. And if it not possible to take this mid value, so just increment your left boundary. So your left boundary would become this one. I think I have explained it enough. Okay, so just you need to calculate this value. Let's solve it here. Int required number of cuts. Okay, if the required number of cuts is less than or equal to k, just my answer would mid high equal to mid minus 1. So now the problem is just to calculate the required number of cards. Okay, so how do we do that? So for int I equals to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, I am going through all the sticks. Okay, so I will require it once again. Okay, so just tell me if your length of your stick is 9, and if your, and then how many cards would be required to get the max value? To get the max value, 4. Just tell me the minimum number of cards that is required to get max value 4. Okay, so basically you are having a stick of length 9, and if you want to find the number of cards that is required for that, your max value would be 4. Just tell me the minimum number of cards required for this stick. Yeah, so what you can do here, not two, I think two is not correct. How you guys are telling two? Okay, yeah, two number of cards. Yeah, it's fine. So basically I thought about the number of parts. So the number of parts would be 3 and your number of cards would be 2. So basically this is your 4, this is your 4, and 4 4 and 1. By the way, there are so many possible cases. You might have 3 4 and 2 as well. Okay, so the minimum number of cuts that is required is 2. So what you can do, so what you did here, 9 divided by 4. Okay, so this is basically 2. Okay, so just tell me if you are having a length of 9 and to find the max value of 4, sorry, to find the max value of 3, how many cuts would be required? How many cards would be required for max value is 3 if your length is 9? By the way, Priyanka, you are not correct. Priyanka, the number of with the minimum number of cards is, that is 2 basically. Aarti, you are correct. Saksham, yeah, Malav, correct. Malav Chakkad, Malav, why 3? Abhishek, yeah, you are correct. Saksham, you are not correct. Why 3? I mean, still you can cut in two number of cuts. Just cut into 3 3 3 3. So just you need to require two number of cuts, minimum number of cuts, I mean. No, if you cut into two parts of length 3 and 6, then your max value is 6, not 3. Okay, yeah, so basically the main point is that if the number is divisible, then you have to subtract 1. I mean 9 divided by 3. So basically this value is 3. So you have to subtract 1 from it. And if the number is not divisible, then just, you know, just that floor value. So basically just you have to take if a of I modulo mid equals to 0. If this is not equal to 0, then your required, let me copy here. It's a very long test. So this plus equals to a of I divided by mid value, else this plus equals to a of I divided by mid minus 1. I mean you have to subtract one from it. So this is the solution. This is the complete solution, I mean. What is the problem? And K, Q was not declared. Okay, yeah. So basically, this is your A. So just let me copy the long test case. So your answer is 29263819. 29263819. Yeah. Okay. So let me submit it here. So okay. So just look at the code and just tell me if you so see it got accepted.
Okay. Rajan, one thing, you can just paste this code over Google Doc, and Saksham has asked one doubt, so you can clear that.
Okay. Let's wait a minute. Okay. So now I have discussed the solution, and if you guys have any doubt, then just ask me. So this is your code. Okay. Because after that, Chirag will discuss some problems, some couple of problems. Okay. By the way, I'm not able to see any doubt here.
If you open your YouTube screen, Saksham has asked, like, why we are not changing the low and high by one, means why are we not changing the low and high by 0.1, and we are changing it by, we are incrementing and decrementing by one. So why we are doing that?
Okay.
Like, because the answer can also be a floating point, we have to round it off. So it should be like we have to increment or decrement by 0.1. So why we are not doing like that?
You know, the reason is that, see, the problem statement, you have to answer it in terms of integer. So there is no need to, you know, to take care of this floating point number, because your final answer is going to be an integer value. So always just play with integer numbers, not real number. I mean, these floating numbers, there is no need. I mean, you may do it, but it is not required, basically, because your final number is going to be an integer value. So always just play with the numbers of integer. That's the reason I am decrementing by one or incrementing by one. That's the only reason. I'm just playing with integer numbers, not floating point numbers. Okay. So finally, just write clear, sir, if you are clear. I mean, if you guys have no doubt, then just write clear, sir. Otherwise, just ask. It's in time.
Sir, where we are checking if the current value is max value? Where the current value is the max value?
Oh. You know, I guess Mayank. Okay. So basically, my approach was absolutely different. I'm not going to check the max value each time. What I assume that in this problem, so my search space was the length of my stick. Okay. So what I did here, I initially assumed that. 1 minute. Okay. So what I did here. So basically, my search space was length of the sticks. Okay. So basically, not length, this is the max length of the sticks. So I initially assumed that my first space is going to be max length. So there is no need to check always each times. That's the reason I'm not going to check, because my search space was maximum length. So basically, this is my maximum length. So I know what is my maximum length current time. So I assume that this is a maximum length. Then I calculated the number of cuts that is required to get this max length. And I just say, if the number of cuts is less than or equals to K, then just take it and just, you know, decrement your higher, change the range, basically, your L and R accordingly. Okay. If the number of cuts is required, which is less than or equal to K, then just answer equals to mid. I mean, you may take it, then high equals to mid minus one. I have decremented my right contour, right boundary. And if it is not possible to take it, then just increment your left boundary. Okay. That's the reason I'm not going to check once each times, because I assume that this is my maximum length.
Mayank Narang. Okay. What about others? I mean,
so Chirag, I think the problem is clear to everyone. So I think you may continue from here. Hello, Chirag.
Okay, I'm continue.
Okay,
so I will tell you some functions, like, which actually what happens is, like, in previous class we have solved one question. think this one C1. So closest to the right. So in this, we were given an array sorted in non-decreasing order, and we needed to find the minimum index of the array such that the number is not less than the given one. So so basically, I want to say that if you are given a sorted array, means you can say A of I is less than equal to A of I plus 1. If such an array is given to you, Rajan, I think your mic is unmute. So meanwhile, you can unmute it. Okay. So if such an array is given to you, and like you need to find the index of you can say the first element which is greater than equal to x. Like you are given a sorted array and the number x, and you need to find the index of first element which is just greater than or equal to x. So what you can do, you can apply binary search or not? Can anyone answer? Actually, I think we solved this same question in the previous. Not less than means either greater than or equal to. So yeah, we solved it in the previous class. So using binary search, we can solve it. We can easily solve it. So this is actually called, you can say it is the lower bound of x. So I want to tell you like every time such a question, whenever you face such a question, like in a sorted array, you need to find the first element which is just greater than or equal to x. So you do not need to write the binary search from scratch. So there is a built-in function in C++ which will save your time many a times. So just remember it. Like there is a function in C++. There is a built-in function to find this in O of log n using binary search. So you just need to call that function. So it will just give you the correct answer. So it is something like, you can say int ind equals to lower bound. Like if the array is A, so we'll write A dot begin. Means it's a sorted vector. For the meanwhile, I'm assuming that it is a vector. For array also it will work, but I'm writing now for a vector. So A dot begin, A dot end, and you write the third argument as the number whose lower bound you want to find. So it will be x. So this thing, this lower bound function will return an iterator to the first element which is just greater than or equal to x. The condition is that the given array should be sorted, or if it is a vector, it should be sorted in non-decreasing order like this. So it will give the iterator to the element which is just greater than or equal to x. So if you need to find the index, you do minus a dot begin. So it will give you this index. This is one thing. And another thing is, like if you need to find index of the first element greater than x, strict inequality is there like this. If you need to find the first element in the array just greater than x, means that cannot be equal to x, but it should be greater than x. So it is called upper bound of x. So there is also, you can also find this by binary search, but if there is a built-in function directly which you can use, so why will you write your own binary search? So for such, if you face the similar question, you can use the built-in function that is called upper bound in C++, upper bound function. So it will also find this. So example is similar to this, just you need to use upper bound. And suppose there is no such element, then ind will be equal to size of the array. Okay. Because this will return the last iterator of the array. If there is no such element which is greater than x, then it will return the, you can say, the last element of that array. So you can say a dot end will be returned, and this thing a dot end minus a dot begin will give you the size of the n. Let us say the size of the array is n, so you will get n here. So this is just, I want to tell you, like it will be used many a times. Like whenever you need to find such things, so you use it directly. You need to remember this. Let us now solve a question now. So I will share the link here. So the link is shared in the live chat, and also I have pasted in the Google Doc also. So the question says that there is an array given to you and it has n integers, n is the size of the array. Now after this array, you are given q queries or k queries. For each query, there are two values, l and r. And for each query, you need to find how many numbers are between l and r. So can anyone give an idea? Just try to think how you can solve this problem. It is not opening. Just you need to sign in to CodeForces. First log in to CodeForces, then it will open. Surely it will open. It should open. First log in with CodeForces, then it should open. So just try to think how can you solve this problem. Like, okay, let us come to the sample input output. If you are not understanding this question, like this is the array given to you. There are five integers, 10, 1, 10, 3, 4. These are the five integers. And you need to find for the next line contains the number of queries. So 4 is the number of queries. Then each query, like these four queries are given, and each query has two integers, L and R. So like first query says one, L is 1, R is 10. So you need to find how many numbers are between 1 and 10. So as you can see, there are all the numbers are between 1 and 10. So the number, the count of the numbers is 5. So your answer is 5. Output is 5. For next query, how many numbers are between 2 and 9? Between means including L and R. L and R included. Okay. So between 2 and 9, how many numbers are there? So except these two tens and this one, like 3 and 4, these two numbers are between 2 and 9. So the count of such number is 2. Like this. For each query, you need to answer. So if you go by the brute force method and you iterate through the whole array, then definitely that would not be a good approach. It will give TLE. Like if you use a for loop for finding how many numbers are between L and R, that will not work here. It will give time limit exceeded. It will not work because the time complexity would be much higher. So we need to use something like binary search or something which can reduce the time complexity. Can you, if you're not getting any idea, then think of, can you use lower bound or upper bound here? Yeah, Sakshab, you answered correctly. Basically, we need to find, like, if I find, like, for, let us say I want to find the answer for 2 to 9. How many numbers are between 2 to 9? So, I can think like this. If I sort this array first, I need to sort this array. Okay, so, let us say I have sorted this array and I have got something like, you can say, I have got 1, 3, 4, 10, 10. So, 1, 3, 4, 10, and 10. These are the five numbers and their indices are 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So let us say I want to find how many numbers are between 2 and 9. So what I do is find the upper bound of this 9. Upper bound means the number, the index which is just, which is having value just greater than 9. Not equal to, just greater than 9. So if I find like the number, the index which is having in the sorted array only, in the sorted array, which index just the first element which is just greater than 9, or you can say in general the first element greater than R. So this is that element here. So my upper bound will be, let us say, some Y. So this is my upper bound. And now let us find the lower bound of L. Lower bound means the element which is just greater than or equal to, because 2 can also be an answer. So just the element which is greater than or equal to 2. So if I found, like, if here I found this element is the first element greater than or equal to 2. So this is the lower bound, right? So this X is the lower bound of 2, lower bound of L. So if I have the lower bound of L, this is X. And if I have the upper bound of R, which is Y, I can subtract these two. So it will give me the range of numbers between L and R, right? So if I subtract y is 3, x is 1. So 3 minus 1 is 2. So you can see there are only two numbers between 2 and 9. So we have got the answer. So I hope you understood my approach. Those who are saying not opening. So just I would say ki first log in to CodeForces and then you open it. Or you if you open it, then you need to log in. Like, okay, let me show you. So like this is the link, and if I log it out, so like if I am opening the link, then it showed no such course, like this thing you might be facing. So just first log in, then only open the link. Like I have logged in now. Now after logging in into my Codeforces account, then I try to open it. Then it will definitely open. Like now it is opening. So just do this thing if you are not able to open the link. Okay. So I hope you understood. We need to find how many numbers are between L and R. So what I did, first I sort the array. And then I just find the upper bound of R, means the first element, which is just greater than R. And I find the first element, which is just greater than or equal to L, the lower bound of L. And then I subtract these two. So I get the answer. So I hope you understood it. So just I can write the code. It will take 1 or 2 minutes, means two, maximum 2 to 3 minutes. So it will not take much time. So the input format is like first line has N, the length of the array, then we have the n integers. So let me write. And if you have any doubt or if you have not understood anything, please feel free to ask in the chat. And I think you should be now able to open this link if you're not able to. So just let me share my screen once again because I want to show my editor. So yeah, this is we are writing code for the D question. So okay, so let me remove these stuff. First input output is also not required here. Okay, so the first line should contain the size of the arrays written in the question. You can see the input format. And then we have been given n integers for the vector. So I create a vector or array. You can also create an array, but I prefer vectors because it is generally preferred vectors whenever you have a variable sized array. So better to use vector. There are many advantages. So let me take the input of all the elements for I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, C in vec of I. And then we have the number of queries k. So let me see in k. And then for each query, so I do while k minus minus so that it runs for all the queries. So this loop will run k times. K minus minus means k will decrease by 1 at every step. So it will run k times. And let us take the, you can say L and R, two variables. Let us take L and R, C in L, C in R. And then what I need to do is like, first, I told you like what we are doing is first we find the lower bound of L, or you can say first we need to sort the array because lower bound and upper bound will not work until and unless your array is not sorted. So it should be sorted. So first sort this array, sort vec dot begin, vec dot end, like this. And then what you do? You need to find how many numbers are between L and R. So you find the index of the first element just greater than R. So let us say it is Y. So I find the upper bound of, you know what is upper bound. So the index of the first element, which is just greater than R. So upper bound of R. So vec dot begin, vec dot end. And then the third element is R because I want to find the upper bound of R minus vec dot begin. Why I'm doing this minus vec dot begin? Because this upper bound function will return an iterator, and since I need to find the index, so I am using this minus vec dot begin. Fine. And then we find the lower bound x equals to. You can also use your own binary search, that will also work, but just I want to show you the function, this use of lower bound and upper bound. That's why I'm showing you. Like if you write the same code by binary search, it will be much lengthier than this. So I can say that many times you will use this upper bound and lower bound. So you should know how to use these. So you find the lower bound of L, and just what you need to do is just subtract these. So you will get the count of the numbers which is falling between L and R. I need to print Y minus X. So it will give me the count of the numbers which is, you can say, between L and R, including L and R. So yeah, this is working for this test case. Let me submit the code. So if I submit it here, it should be submitted here. fast search if I submit it. Yeah, it is accepted. I will also paste this code over the Google Doc. So if you have any doubt, please feel free to ask. Logged in is still same error. Okay. So it should not be like that. What can be the cause then? I think. Okay. So what you can do if you are logged in, then also you are facing the error, just go to Edu section. Like after logging in, go to this Edu section and then just go to this enter. Okay, just follow these steps and then you go to this binary search practice, this step one practice. Okay, I zoom it a little bit. So step one practice. Now here you will definitely find this D part. So we were solving this one earlier. So this one. So you will definitely find this question by this way. Go to Edu section and then the ITMO course, just enter that or register, enter whatever option is there. And then from that, just go to binary search section and step one and step one practice. So you will find this D part faster. So we solved this question now. Now, let us come to another question if you are clear with this one. Just give me a confirmation whether you are able to open this now or not. Okay. So let us solve one better question now. So you can open this one, step two in the practice section. Step two practice section. And in this E part, E equation, we will discuss both D and E first, since E is easier. So first let us discuss this one, and this one we will learn a new thing. Like we will learn how to apply binary search on, you can say, floating points. So in this part, just I will share the link. Again, still, if you are not able to open this, then I will say go to Edu section, go to that ITMO course, register over there, and then you will find this thing, a binary search option, binary search step two. So go to binary search step two, and then go to practice section. And in practice section, you go to E part. So you can also access this question this way. So definitely we will be able to open this. Okay, opened. We have to register first. Yeah, it may be possible that you have to first register for the course and then it will open. Fine. So anyways, you can open this question now. Equation. So this equation is given to you. X square plus root x equals to c. So means we need to find, like, c is given in your input. Input contains this c and c is a floating point number. And you need to find a number x such that it satisfies the equation. So since x can be a floating point number, it can be a decimal, like it can be anything, like in this you are getting such a floating point answer. So you can see that in such a type of questions, there is always given in the output format that you need to print the answer with a relative or absolute error, not more than such some values given. So which is here 10 to the power minus 6. So basically in every floating point answer, in every floating point question, you will find such a thing. So this is very important. Like in whenever you're writing the code, this thing will be used, that your answer should not have the error more than this. Because actually what happens is whenever you submit your code to the CodeForces platform or to any platform, so what it does is it the checker works in such a way that it will check the difference between the actual answer and your answer. If that difference, if the absolute difference or relative difference between those answer, your answer and the actual answer, if this is more than that, if this is more than this precision value, 10 to the power minus 6, then it will give you wrong answer. And if you are, suppose that the answer is 1.0 and you outputted 0.99999999. So still, if you find the difference between 0.99999999 and 1, the difference is less than 10 to the power minus 6. So it will get accepted. It will not give wrong answer. Because this thing is important. If the difference of the correct answer and your answer is less than 10 to the power minus 6, it will get accepted. So this is the thing. So, okay. So in such a type of question, the thing is ki you are given an equation, you need to solve it. So first, let us see what this function actually is. X square plus root x. So the function is something like, it is given x square plus root x. So can anyone say, is this a monotonic function or not? If it is monotonic, then it is increasing or decreasing, or non-increasing, non-decreasing, what you can say about this function. Let us say this is f of x. So if you draw the graph, means I don't know, I don't want to draw the exact graph, but just you need to tell the nature, like it should be increasing or decreasing, non-increasing, non-decreasing, what? And one thing is there, the value of this function is always greater than 1. So this constant is always greater than 1. So don't consider this 0 to 1 part. Always this, I should say, if here I have x and if I have f of x here. So just consider the part which has a value of greater than 1. Okay. This is given in the question that the constant value c is greater than or equal to 1. And it can be up to 10 to the power 10. So it should be increasing. Yeah, it should be increasing. Fine. So x greater than this, whenever your function value is greater than 1, it should be something like increasing. So if you increase x, f of x will increase, something like this. So here we can definitely apply binary search. There is nothing to think of it. But just one thing I want to tell you through this question is, whenever you apply binary search or floating point, what should be the difference? So let us try to write the code for it, so you will understand by coding along the way. So like, we need to take only one input, which is c. And we need to output the required value of x, which satisfies this particular equation. So let me take the input. So this is our question. And in this, I'm using CPE editor. So if for competitive programming, this editor is actually very useful. Like here, a submit option is also there. If you want to directly submit to Codeforces, it will submit it directly. I have just configured it that way. So you can download it also, CPE editor, you can search it. So this is the interface is actually good for if you want to test for many test cases, and just you want to run your code directly over all the test cases at once simultaneously, so it will work fine. And here, since we need to check for accuracy of 1e-6, 10 to the power minus 6, so I use this checker so that it would work fine. And then let us write the code now. So basically, we need to take two inputs, which is only one input, the constant c. And we need to find a value of x which satisfies the equation. So, okay, one thing, like whenever you are writing a code for double, or you can say floating point, so don't use double or floating point. Better to always use long double. Similar, like if you have int, then there may be overflow. Like if you use int, then sometimes it may cause overflow. Similarly, in floating point questions, if you use float, then it may not give you correct answer many times. So better to use long double always in such questions. Okay. Whenever you use decimal type, you better to use long double. So I will take, one thing you can do, like again, like if I write a long double, I want to take, let us say, two variables, x and c. So I write long double x, then again, I need to take long double high and low. So long double low, long double high, long double mid. So again and again, I need to repeat this long double, this big thing. So instead of repeating this again and again, you can use this thing. Either you can use hash define or you can use the type def. Type def, it will always replace, like if I write this way, long double LD. So what it will do is give, now you do not need to write long double again and again. You need to just write LD. What it will do is, or you can give any name of yours. Like I want to write L or LED, any name you can give. So what it will do is, it will just whenever you write in your code this LD or something like this, whatever name you have given, so it will replace that name by this thing. So you are giving basically a second name to your data type. Like some of you might have heard that some people have two names. One we call someone by a pet name. So similarly, it gives this since this long double is a data type, so it gives a pet name to a data type. So this is this type def. So the type def syntax is type def, then the original data type, then your pet name for this data type. So like here I write LD. So I have declared two variables, x. Let us say we need only one variable here. I will see in C. And then, okay, so since we need to run a binary search, I need low and high and mid. So what should be the low value, since the function value is always greater than equal to 1? So I can say that if you put x equal to 1 is in this equation, you will find that this f of x, like I mean to say that f of 1, if you put x in x equal to 1 in this above function, you will get 1, square of 1 plus root of 1. So you can say that minimum the function value will always be greater than 1. And means I mean to say that since the function value is greater than equal to 1, you can also conclude that x should be always greater than equal to 1. Why? Because it is an increasing function. So if your function, since it is given that say c is always greater than equal to 1, c means the function value, since this is equal to c, x square plus root s is equal to c. So you can say a function value is always greater than equal to 1. And since the function is increasing, you can say that x is also greater than equal to 1, because f of 1 is 1. Okay. So what we can do is our low value in the binary search should be 1, right? And high, what should the high value be? So if you think of the high value, you can just, what is the maximum value of C? You can take it that, like here, since the function value is 10 to the power 10, so you can take it that way, because definitely x square, if you put x square plus root x, so you need your function value is always less than equal to 10 to the power 10. I mean to say ki, you can say it is given in the question that f of x is equal to c and f of x is less than equal to 10 to the power 10. So always, definitely, since it is an increasing function, and you know that you can also put x in the equation f of x, so you will get that for when I put x equal to 10 to the power 10, I get something more than 10 to the power 20 or something. So we are safe. Like we can use high as 10 to the power 10. So high I can take as 10 to the power 10. I can write it 1e10. Fine. And we have taken a mid variable. Now, one thing interesting is, like, normally in binary search, what you have written up till now, while low less than equal to high. But here, for floating point data types, you cannot use this way, because it will not work correctly. Why? Because in floating point, what happens is, like, you have supposed two floating point numbers. One is 0.00001, something like this, and one is 0.000011, something like this. So actually, these numbers are approximately equal, like, but you can say that, I mean to say that these are approximately equal, and you want to consider them equal. But still, if you use less than equal to sign, it will not work. Like, the compiler will consider this number is smaller than this one, right? But you want to consider them as same, because in the question it is written that, like you can see in the question, it is written your answer x should, it can have an error of 10 to the power minus 6, but not more than that, right? So this much error we always tolerate. So what we can do is, instead of writing low less than equal to high, since this is inaccurate, for floating point number, we cannot use this less than equal to directly, or equal to sign also we do not use directly. We use something like, we take a variable epsilon, or which is the error we can tolerate. So here this is, you can say, EPS I am taking the variable s, and in this question it is given as 1e-6. Epsilon is basically the error you can tolerate, up to what extent you can tolerate the error. So here it is 10 to the power minus 6, so I can write it at as 1e-6. It is same as 10 to the power minus 6. So we will repeat the binary search until high minus low is greater than equal to this epsilon. So suppose that high minus low is, suppose low becomes greater than high, so it will break out of the loop. Or suppose the difference is very less now. Suppose high and low are very close now. So we have actually found the answer. We will break out of the loop. So that is why we place the condition of the while loop as high minus low greater than equal to epsilon. Because we need to repeat whenever this high minus low, this difference is greater than epsilon, we will repeat the loop. Like initially you see the difference between high and low is very large, 10 to the power 10. So we need to repeat the loop. That is why this condition will be true, and it will repeat the loop up till when the difference between high and low is very less, or you can say the low is greater than low becomes greater than high, then it will break the loop. Okay. So you take a mid calculation is same as the normal integer value what we did earlier, low minus high minus low by 2, low plus high minus low by 2. And what you need to do, just check now at this mid value, I will check the value of the function. So I put the value in the function, like mid in what is the function? it is x square plus root x. So x square plus root x. So mid into mid plus square root of mid. This is the function f of x is this, f of mid is this. So I will find the value of the function at mid. And now I will check. Let us say this this is, you can say val. Let me give the name to this variable val. And I will check whether this value, actually, if you see, there are like only you can say that you can consider it as like there are two cases. Like this value will be either less than equal to this constant c, or it may be greater than c. These are the only possible two cases. So what we can do is, if I can write it like this, if this value is less than equal to c, so what we can do, or there will be another case when it is greater than c. So if it is, if this value is less than equal to c, what should I write here? Can anyone tell? Should I, because in binary search, whenever you want to change your search space, there are only two cases, low equal to mid plus 1 or high equal to mid minus 1. So which thing should I write here? Whenever this value is less than equal to c, since it is an increasing function, so what I need to find, let us say value is less than c, so value is very less. So you need to find a value which is equal to c. So you need to increase your x, because your function is increasing function. So if you increase x, function will automatically increase. So you need to increase your, you can say, you need to increase your low equal to mid plus 1. You need to go to the, you can say, to the right of mid. You need to increase your low. You need to increase your mid, actually, so that your function value will increase. Because the function value at mid is very less. It is less than equal to c. So, but you need to find a value which is equal to c. Okay. So we increase low equal, increase such as low equal to mid plus 1. In the else part, when this value is greater than c, definitely you need to decrease your region or decrease your mid value so that we get closer to c. Because if val is, this else part will be true when val is greater than c. So suppose val is very large, but you need to decrease it. So you do high equal to mid minus 1. But the problem is, you do this in normal binary search whenever you deal with integers. But the problem is, like, if I do like this, what will happen? Okay. The link is covering the screen. Okay, let me hide it. Okay. So what I wanted to say is, what we need is, we need to get a closer value as much as possible, closer to c. So we did this. But in this way, this will work definitely fine if you're dealing with integers, like the plus 1, low equal to mid plus 1, high equal to mid minus 1, this is what we earlier did. But what we are currently dealing with, floating point numbers or double numbers, where the numbers are decimal, 1.555666, something like this. So if we do this, then what actually will happen is, let me illustrate you here over this whiteboard. So let me say that suppose my low was, let us say low was 1.5, okay. High was, let us say, it can be anything. High was, let us say, 2.4. So what is the mid value here? Mid value, if you take low plus high minus low by 2, or you can average these two values, so you get the mid value as 1.85. 3.9 divided by 2 is 1.85, I think. Okay, 1.985, maybe. I don't know the exact answer. It should be 1.95 or 1.85. So whatever it is, like, it will be something like this. So if you, let us say, if you want to increase your low by low equal to low plus 1. So what you will, low equal to mid plus 1. So what you will do is, low becomes, if I do low equal to mid plus 1, then you will directly jump from low, from this 1.85, you will do 2.85. You will do low equal to mid plus 1. So you will make your low is 2.85. But do you feel it is correct? Since we are dealing with floating point numbers, actually what we need to do is, we need to consider all the numbers which are after mid, right? We need to consider even 1.85001. This is also a number. Although it is not an integer, but it is a number. So we need to consider this number since it is greater than mid. We need to, since we are dealing with an increasing function, so we want to, since in this case, whenever the value is less than equal to c, we want to increase the value. So we want to go for all the numbers which are greater than mid. So we want to increase the range. Means we want to increase we want to search in the range in the space after mid. We want to search the number such that the number lies after mid. But this, if we do low equal to mid plus 1, so low will become 2.85, and we will never come across this number. We will never deal with this number. Similarly, 1.9, we will not deal with this number. 2.1, even we will forget this number if I do low equal to mid plus 1. So we will not do like this. Whenever you are dealing with floating point, remember that you cannot do low equal to mid plus 1 or high equal to mid minus 1. So then what should we do? Can anyone say? How should we update low and high value? Low equal to mid, yes. So yes, instead of plus 1, we will do low equal to mid, high equal to mid. This should work definitely fine. Okay. And at last, what we need to print? We just print, since this loop will break when high and low are very close. Let us say high and low is 2.00001, high is 2.00002, something like this. So they are very close, then only it will break. Okay. So it will break only when they are very close. And that time, whatever was the value of mid, that should be your answer. So you print C out mid. So I think it should work fine. Yeah, it is working. And also you can do one thing, since whenever you are printing the answer for a floating point number, decimal number, you do a fixed set precision and how many digits after decimal you want to print. Like here in the question, it is given that error should be not more than 10 to the power minus 6. So basically it means that up to 6 places of decimal you should print. So better to print one extra. So let me print 7 places of decimal. So what does it do is set precision actually just after decimal, how many digits you want to print, it sets that value. So if I set 7, it will print exactly 7 places after decimal. You can see like here currently it is printing 1. Let me run the code again. It will print 1.00 up to 7 zeros. And fixed means it will just fix the number of you can say decimal places. So actually there is one more we are using this 1e minus 6, such type of convention is there. So it will, if you do not use this fixed, it will print the number in this format. So it may give wrong answer in that case if you do not use fixed here. So always remember this, whenever you are printing your answer for a floating point or floating point or double type answer, decimal answer basically, I mean. So use these two things, fixed and set precision. So inside set precision, give the value as the number of decimal places you want to print in your answer. So let me run this again. Yeah, it is working fine. So let me submit this code. So equation, this problem is there. Okay, let us see, is it working or not? Yeah, it is accepted, you can see. So also let me place the code here, and if you have any doubt, please feel free to ask. Okay, fine. Welcome. Okay, so let us discuss this last question. This is a good problem on binary search. Like, let us solve this problem. So just I will give you time for this problem to let you think, and then we will discuss this. So I will paste the link over the doc. I will place the link over the chat, and then we will discuss this. So yeah, it is this one. Children holiday. Step 2, practice D part. Okay. So let me read the question for you. So the organizers of children's holiday are planning to inflate M balloons. So basically our target is to inflate exactly M balloons, not more than that and not less than that. And they have invited N assistants. And the ith assistant is actually inflates the balloon in ti minutes. And this t is actually given in the form of an array. You can say there are, for each assistant, you are being given a different ti value. Ti minutes is the time taken by that assistant to fill one balloon or inflate one balloon. But every time after zi balloons are inflated, he gets tired. So a zi is a value after how many balloons he gets tired. like after inflating how many balloons he will get tired. So it is different for every eye. It is different for every eyeth assistant. Means it may be same for some of them, but like for every assistant, you are given these three values: TI, ZI, and YI. YI is what after inflating ZI balloons, he will take some rest. And what rest is? The rest is having a time limit of, or you can say, duration of YI minutes. Okay. Now, for each assistant, you are being provided with these three values: TI, ZI, and YI. And now your aim is to inflate exactly M balloons. Now the organizers of the holiday want to know how, after what time all the balloons would be inflated with most optimal work of the assistants, and how many balloons each of them will inflate. So yeah, the target is the same. You need to inflate exactly M balloons. For each assistant, you are given three values. TI is the time to fill or inflate one balloon. And after inflating ZI balloons, suppose ZI is 2. So after filling 2 balloons, that person will get tired. And he will require a rest. So he will require a rest for YI time, YI minutes. So you need to find that what is the time required to, what is the minimum time? After what time, what all balloons will be inflated. So means what is the exact time or minimum time, basically, I would say, key to fill exactly M balloons. And how many balloons each of them will inflate. So for each assistant, you need to just also print like assistant 1, how many balloons he will print, assistant 2, how many balloons he will fill, like so on. So you can see this example in this test, in this particular example. So if you have any doubt, feel free to ask, like if you have not understood the question or something. So if you see this example, there are M and N. M first is the M means how many balloons you want to fill. One balloon only you need to fill. And N is the number of assistants. So there are 2 assistants, TI, ZI, and YI. For each assistant, you are given these three values. First assistant is this one. Second is this one, like this. So TI for first is 2. So it means that first person required 2 minutes to fill one balloon. And after filling every one balloon, he will take a rest of 1 minute. Fine. TI, ZI, and YI. These three values are given. So similarly for the second one, 1, 1, 2 means one is the time taken to fill one balloon. This second one indicates that he needs to take rest after filling every one balloon. And what rest? 2 minutes rest after filling every one balloon. Okay. So this is this. And like if you need to fill only one balloon, so here an optimal answer could be 1. Like in 1 minute only, you can fill all the balloons, all the required 1 balloon. How is it possible? This first person, let him not do anything. Let him sit idle. This second person, let him fill a balloon. So he will fill a balloon in 1 minute exactly. And just that is it. Like our work is over. So it will, you can see that it will also take rest of 2 minutes after that, but we'll not count the rest. In bracket, you have been given that if the assistant has inflated the balloon and it needs to rest, but if in future he will not have to inflate more balloons, then he will not take that rest. Okay. Means obviously, like he will only take rest when he needs to inflate some balloons in the future. Otherwise, you do not need to include that rest time. Basically, it means to say that. You can read that whole sentence, it means the same. So we will not include the rest time here. We will include this only filling time. Because although it is needing rest, but the thing is, our work is over. Our target is over. We do not need more balloons, so we will not count the last rest of every assistant. Okay. Had this value been like, if we need to fill 2 or 3 balloons, then it may be possible that we have taken some rest here. But since only it needs to fill one balloon and our work is over, so we do not need to count that rest. So let me give you 5 minutes to think. So. Let me take okay to up to 4 minutes. You take up to 10:23. Think, and then you can share your approach over the chat. The question link is also available in the live chat, also in the Google Doc. Yeah. If you cannot think of anything, then try to think that can you find a monotonic function here? So this image is also I pasted on in the Google Doc. So if you have any idea, you can write over the comments in the live chat, I mean. Whatever idea you have got, if you found a monotonic function, like what monotonic function we can see here, if you have got an idea of that, you can mention it. Or if you have, instead of binary search, if you have got any other approach, then also you can mention it. Anyone? Feel free to write your approach. You can share it, like there is nothing to feel shy in it. Okay, so you have told that we can create a prefix array up to time t. How many balloons were filled? So in what way you will fill the balloons, like in the most optimal way we need to fill it. And okay, so the number of balloons is, it can be up to 15,000, or you can say 1.5 into 10 to the power 4, and there are 1,000 people, and each one can take up to 100 minutes for filling one balloon, and it may require up to 1,000 minutes for rest. So in the worst case, if you multiply these things, 1,000 plus 100 multiplied by the number of balloons, so let us say we have only one person available, and we, he in the worst case, this is the case, like we have only one person available, So in the let us say we have only one person, n equal to 1 in the worst case, and he has ti equal to 100 in the worst case and zi equal to 1000. So 100 plus 1000 and y, let us say it is 1. So 100 plus 1000 is 1100, or you can say 10 to the power, approximately 10 to the power 3 into this m. So you will get it is 10 to the power 9 or something like that. So you cannot build a such a large prefix array. So 10 it because it will go up to 10 to the power 9 or something, 10 to the power 8 or 9. So it will not be optimal. Like it, you cannot create such a large array. Okay, so we need to think something related to binary search only. So that it may, if, because binary search will reduce our time complexity as well as the space complexity by a very large factor. Like that, the time complexity would be log of the range over which you are searching for. So let us see now how can we solve this problem. So what I think is, like, since we need to inflate m balloons, let us say let us define a function as something like we need to find the time to inflate m balloons. So let me define the function like this. Let us say I have a function f of x. Like f of x is, you can say it something like we need to fill exactly m balloons. So let me say that, what can I say is, okay, so let us say fx is number of balloons which we can fill if we have x, if we have time up to x minutes, number of balloons that can be filled. We fill in x minutes. So if I define a function like this, can you think, is it a monotonic or not? And if it is monotonic, then is it strictly increasing, decreasing, or what? Or no, or non-decreasing, non-increasing, what you can say? So basically, I mean to say that let f of x be number of balloons that can be inflated or filled in x minutes. So if you increase the number of minutes, if you increase the time, can you inflate more balloons, or maybe equal or more balloons, right? Okay, so Mayank Narang, you are telling that it should be 10 to the power 6, but actually, if you multiply 1.5 into 10 to the power 4 by 1000, you will get 10 to the power 1000 plus 11, so it should be 10 to the power 7, more than 10 to the power 7 and less than 10 to the power 8. So it should not be 10 to the power 6 if you multiply 1000 by this, and actually it is not 1000 plus 100 multiplied by this. So it should be, okay, let us solve this. What should be the expression? I hope you all are understanding what we are calculating. In the worst case, how many minutes we need to take to fill all the balloons. So in the worst case, it may be possible that we need to fill all the 15,000 balloons, right? And we have only one person available, n equal to 1. We are just thinking of the worst case. What can be the most worst case? The worst case, I mean. So, and let us say that person takes a rest of very large rest of 1,000 minutes. And TI is also, let us say, 100. So the total time which you will take is 1000 plus 100 for one balloon. So 1100, I mean to say 1100 is time for one balloon, total time, rest plus the time to fill it. And then you need to fill 15,000 balloons into 15,000. You get this value. There are 5 0s 6 7, so it is 1.6 into 10 to the power 7, something like this. So you cannot create such a large prefix array, I think. And if you can, okay, maybe it may be possible you can create such a large array. But the thing is, for each, if you try to create a prefix array, what should be the time complexity for it? Since for getting each value, you need to go through all the assistants. So you multiply for getting the time complexity of this. For if you go by this, your approach, then it should be, you need to multiply this by n again, because you need to go through all the steps again for the calculating the prefix array. So it should be into 1000 if I do. So it is very large. You cannot tolerate this much time complexity. So we cannot go by this approach. So we need to think of binary search, obviously. So now let us come back again to what the function I was talking about. Like, you have a function f of x, like it is telling you number of values that can be filled in x minutes. So obviously, if you have more than x minutes, so definitely the number of balloons which you can fill is either equal to f of x, earlier f of x, or it may be greater than f of x, earlier f of x. So you can say when you increase x, f of x will either increase or it will remain same. So it is a monotonic non-decreasing function. So it is a monotonic non-decreasing function, right? All of you agree or not? Yes. So why? Because if you increase the x value, f of x will remain same or it will be increasing. So it cannot decrease at any cost. So fine. Now it should be clear that if I can find a value which is means I can find binary by using binary search this value. So okay, let us now write the code. So it is not that easy. It may seem at first like now I think I have got the answer. It may seem to you like this, but let us write the code. We will understand what difficulties we are going to face. So let me share the screen once again. Fine. So hash define and int long, so that overflows never occur. Then let us see the input format. So input format is, we have two integers m and n. So let me take m and n. Here we are dealing with integers only, so our normal binary search would work. So okay, and then we have the array of means this ti, zi and yi values. So we can take three arrays for it, or three vectors you can say. For each assistant, these three values are given. So I am taking three arrays, let us say t, y, what is the order, t, z and then y. So t, z and then y, and the size of vector you can give it directly also, and so if you give the size directly, you do not need to use pushback function. Directly you can see in that value, like a normal to like similar to an array. So and for int I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, you take these input ti, then zi, then yi. Fine. Now, I think this is the correct order. Yes, we have taken the input. Now, just we are running a binary search over the we can say over the time or over the number of balloons that can be inflated in x minutes. So, so we are doing a binary search over the time. Okay. So x, we are doing binary search over the time, over x is time, x in minutes. So what we can do is what is the lowest possible time to fill one balloon? Means, let us say we have to fill all the m balloons. So what should be the lowest possible time to fill it? So if you cannot think of any other thing, you can take it as like lowest time can be taken as zero. It should not affect it much. Like if I take it, the lowest time is zero. And what should be the highest time? We just calculated it now. So highest time was approximately 10 to the power 8. Right, so I can take it 1 8. It was actually less than this, but in the worst case, it should be the highest time should be this one, this much only, not more than this. And apart from this, we need a mid variable for doing our binary search. And let us perform the binary search now. So what we need to do is, while low less than equal to high, normal integer binary search that we did earlier, that thing only. And for now, you will get a mid value. Mid equals to low plus high minus low by 2. Now, for this mid value, you can say that you need to find the number of balloons that can be inflated in mid minutes. In x equal to mid minutes, you can say. Means you need to find the function value at this point x equal to mid, right? So what is the function? Function is number of values that can be inflated in x minutes. So how will you find that? This is the question.
So how to find this? Can anyone answer?
You are given a time, let us say t equal to mid, and you need to find how many balloons can you inflate, how many maximum number of balloons you can inflate in that time. The conditions you all know, ti is the time required to inflate one balloon, zi is the number of balloons after which that person requires a rest. After filling zi balloons, requires a rest. After filling every zi balloons, requires a rest. Better to say this way. And the rest should be of yi minutes, like this. So you know this, these conditions. And for each assistance, you are given these ti, zi, and yi values. So you need to find how many balloons can you fill or can you inflate in this x equal to mid minutes. Some x values given, you need to find f of x. How will you find this f of x? This is the question now. Okay, you think of that. Let me write the remaining code. Suppose I have x. Suppose I have calculated f of x. So let me, let us say I have calculated f of x, and let us say that number is coming to me. You can say something. You can let us say the number is coming to me num. Let num equal to. Let us say we have a function get balloons. I will write this function later on. You try to answer in live chat. How will you calculate this get balloons? Get balloons means the number of balloons which can be filled in this x minutes. Or you can say this f of x. How will you calculate this f of x for mid? Okay. So after we have this value, after we have this f of x normal binary search, what we will do is, if this number of balloons is greater than equal to m, so it means that what you need to do, you can, if you have filled more than m balloons or equal to m balloons, what you need to do, you need to just you can say we take a variable answer, and answer can be initialized as something like zero or something, whatever you want. If you do not initialize it, then also it will work fine here in this case. Anyways, so if you can fill more than m balloons, what you do, you store this answer as the answer mid, and mid is the time which has been taken to fill these many balloons. And what you do else is you can do one thing. Achha, we will store the number for each instance. We also need to calculate the number of balloons each assistance is filling. So we will calculate it later on. Don't worry about that. Just let us first find what is the optimal time taken to fill the number of balloons. And if this number, if this f of x is less than m, definitely what we will do, we will increase the time by some value, low equal to mid plus one, we will do. And otherwise, we will search in the left half, in the left of mid, like we will do high equal to mid minus one. We will see that in less time also, can we inflate these many balloons, because we need to find the minimum time required to fill these many balloons. So you do not need to find the any time, you need to find the minimum time to fill such m balloons, because in the question it is written that the inflated with most optimal work for all assistants. Most optimal means you need to find the minimum time actually to fill all the balloons, all the m balloons. So again, I move back to my question again, like what should be, how you calculate this get balloons, or you, how you calculate f of x for a value x. Can anyone answer? So very less people are now connected. Is my voice breaking or something like that, or is it clear? Just please write. Okay, it's clear. Okay, so just try to think how will you calculate this get balloons now. For a given time, you need to calculate how many balloons can you fill in that time. Can anyone answer? Just what idea you are getting, just basic idea, just tell this. If you are getting an equation, you can write that. If you are getting any idea, like how can you calculate it? Okay, someone has told, can we take LCM? So if you take LCM, it will not work. Like in this case, if you take LCM,
Rajan, are you saying something? Yes, yes, yes. Ah, yes, you can leave, yes. Okay, okay, okay.
So like if you take LCM of 2 and 1 here, you get 2. Okay. So LCM of what? You need also to mention that. Like LCM will actually... one more thing, like you might have a doubt. Actually these all assistants will work in parallel. Like they are all independent. Like you have been given all the M balloons and they need to fill it. They need to inflate it. So they can work parallelly. Like they are all independent. So don't worry that after the first test completed its work, then only second will start. It is not like that. So they are all working independently. So you calculate the, you can say that you, if you can also first calculate for each assistant, what is the balloons he is filling, and you sum it up. Is it the basic idea you are getting? Like for each assistant, you go to each assistant. Like I'm going to this ith assistant. I'm asking him how much balloons you can fill in this mid time, in this x equal to mid time. How many balloons can you fill? I will take the answer for this ith assistant and I will add up it to my answer. Like in this way, after adding up for the answer for all the assistants, I will get how many balloons can I fill in this mid time or in any x equal to mid time. So this is the basic idea, but for each person you need to calculate how many balloons he can fill in this TI time. So any idea for that, how we'll calculate it? Time, my approach was prefix, but it is not working. So it will not work. Divide mid by ZT plus Y for each assistant. Okay. And their sum will be total number of balloons in mid time. So mid by ZT plus Y. So you are multiplying Z by T and plus Y. So Y is time for rest, but Z and T should not be multiplied, I think. Because T is the time to fill one balloon and Z is the number of balloons after which he will require rest. Like Z is, let us say, 3. So it means that after filling 3 balloons, he will take a rest. It is like that. Divide mid by Z. So this will not work. Like this sum will be total. Okay. So you can try many approaches. Try to think of your own approach. But I'm sharing my approach, how I solved it. Like, can you think of one more binary search on this? Like, now we need to find this function, get balloons. So let us declare, so let me call another function, let g of x equals to number of balloons that one person or one person can fill or can inflate in x minutes, like this. Or maybe I can write it as you can write it this way. Okay, one person, how much balloons he can fill in x minutes. So now the same function, can I declare it for like one person? And again you will find that it is also a monotonic decreasing function, non-decreasing, I mean. So inside binary search, I'm applying another binary search here. I mean to say that now this I'm creating this a separate function. Now actually this get balloons will take, we can take two things. One thing we can do is take a count variable here, count equal to 0. And for each assistant, I will go and sum up the count values, sum up these get balloons values. Okay. So for I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, for each of the person, I'm calculating how many balloons can I get. So to get the number of balloons, I will pass these three things, ti, zi, and yi. So ti, zi, and yi. So let us create this function now. How to get the number of balloons this ith assistant can inflate in x equal to mid time. So this is my function, let us say get balloons. So it is taking x is the number, x is the, I will write here, x is the
time. You can say x is the time. Time provided. ठीक है. And return, it will return the you can say the number of balloons, maximum balloons it can fill in, this ith person can fill in this x time, number of balloons, maximum number of balloons that this person can fill in t equal to x minutes. Fine, we will take three values. I told you ti, let me name these three integers as ti. One more integer we are taking is zi, and one more is yi. You know that what is the meaning of these three. So how I will calculate is I apply binary search again here. Low equals to, again let us say low equal to 0, and high equals to the same thing, 188. And let us take mid here, while low less than equal to high. Binary search, we are doing mid equals to low plus high minus low by 2. Why I'm writing this way? To prevent overflow. You can write low plus high by 2, but I will tell ki avoid that and write this way, because it will definitely help you many times to prevent overflow. So now after this, just what we need to do is ki we are applying binary search again. So for this person, if you are given, for one person you are given a time t, so for one person how can you calculate it? Someone you answered a equation like you can divide by zt plus y, something like this, but that will not work. A similar equation you can actually derive is ki, in the question if you read it carefully, what it is given is ki, I told you, okay, the last balloon whatever he will fill, he will not take rest for it. So remembering this, we can derive an equation for x minutes. For I'm going to ith person, for one person I am talking now, ki how much time he will fill, how much time he will take to fill x balloons. So let me think in the different way, like we can think in this way ki, okay, let me think in this way ki, for x balloons, I'm declaring my gx as something like this ki, time taken by one person to inflate x balloons. Now it would be very easy for you, because if you are given the number of balloons, you can easily calculate the time. But the reverse is very difficult. If you are given the number, if you are given the minute, it will be very difficult to calculate how many balloons he can fill for one person. But if you are given that you need to fill exactly x balloons, and for one person you know ti, zi and yi, so you can easily calculate what is the time taken, right? What will be the answer if you are given x balloons and you need to take the, you need to find the time taken to fill, inflate x balloons? And is it a non-decreasing function or non-increasing? So definitely if time will increase, balloons can more, it can be inflated more. Sorry, if balloons will increase, then time will be more. So it is non-decreasing. Okay. So I mean to say that if x is, let us say, number of balloons, and number of balloons. So what is the time taken by ith assistant to fill those? Can anyone tell? So the time taken will be time taken by ith assistant will be, ith assistant is, it's easy, right? You have been given three values, ti, zi and yi. So definitely if you think it, like if you need to fill x balloons, then definitely it will take x into t time, right? So it should be x into t plus something, x into t plus something. What should be that? How much time he is taking the rest? Okay, x into ti I can write, so it is, I am writing is, it as t now, x into t plus you can say the rest time. So the rest time is simple, mid, because since for the last balloon you do not need the rest, it is given in the question. So mid minus 1 I am doing, or x minus 1, So you can do x minus 1, since you need to fill x balloon. So last balloon, you're not including x minus 1 divided by z, because for every z balloons, it requires a rest. So how many rest he will require? X minus 1 divided by z. Easy. This is the number of rest, and each rest is of y minutes. So you get this time in this way. I hope it is clear. If it is not, then please tell. So just apply this equation. So you will get like, you can say t. I am writing it as gx. So gx would means the time. Gx is the time taken to fill mid balloons. X equal to mid balloons. So what is the time? Just I wrote the equation. So it is here x equal to mid. So just replace wherever there is x in this equation, just replace by mid. So you will get mid mid into ti plus what is it? Xi x x minus 1. So mid minus 1 by zi into yi. So x minus 1. X is mid. Mid minus 1 it should be. And divided by zi into yi. Right? Now definitely you can answer that if this thing, if this is a this is time required, so if this time required is less than equal to the time we are searching the answer for, so we are searching the answer for time equal to t equal to x. So if this thing, if gx, okay, let us not take it gx, it will be confusing maybe. Let us take it gx only, and let us say this is something else. This is p, or maybe we can take t. T भी नहीं रहेगा सही. We can take something like, okay, let us p, let it be p. So p is the time provided to us, and we have not more than this time. So if this time take, if the time required to fill this these many balloons, if it is within the range of this p, then it is good. Like it is nice. We can store the answer. So let us take a variable answer, int answer, and let us say it is zero initially. So if we are able to fill this mid balloons, then I will store the answer as answer equal to mid. Otherwise, if this time required is greater than p, we do not have so much time, so we will not store the answer. Now what changed low and high we will make? So if you can fill these many balloons, so you will try to find whether you can fill these many balloons in less time. So you will search for, you can say, sorry, time taken, like I mean to say, if you can if the time is within the range, you will try to find whether you can fill more balloons. Okay, so you will do low equal to mid plus 1, because you want to find the maximum number of balloons. Suppose that gx is less than equal to p, so if it is less than, then you will try to find, okay, let me see whether I can fill more balloons in this time or not. So you will check for that. So low equal to mid plus 1, but definitely we will not check for less number of balloons, because if you can fill these mid balloons, then definitely mid minus 1 also you can fill, mid minus 2 also you can fill, and you can also fill mid minus 3 balloons definitely, because it is an increasing function. So if you decrease the value of x, then f of x will decrease, so you will be able to fill x minus 1 balloons definitely within this time limit. So otherwise, if you are not able to fill in this time limit of p minutes, what you will do? You will increase your, you will decrease your high value, high equal to mid minus 1, like this. So now this will decrease the number of balloons. So it will, maybe that we will be able to find an optimal answer. Basically, we are doing a binary search on the number of balloons that the person can fill. So how we are doing that? We are finding how much time it is taking. If the time is less than equal to p, okay, if you want to think like this, you can think like this also. We have an array of zeros and ones, and always this thing is very useful. Like I use it always. Like if you can fill your balloons in time less than equal to p, let us write. If you can fill your balloons in time less than equal to p, right? Let us write 1, 1, 1. So it will be something like this. But after a certain x, or after a certain fx, this f of x will become 0, 0, 0, 0. So it is a function like this. If I am declaring the function as, let us say some h of x is my function, equal to
the number of balloons I can fill in this x time, is this less than equal to this p value? So either it will be true or false. If this is true, so initially it will be true for some lower values, but as you increase the number of balloons, then definitely the time will if you increase the number of balloons, the time will increase, and this time will be at one moment it will be greater than p, so it will be this condition will become false. It will be 000 something like this. So you need to find this last one. You need to find what maximum balloons can you fill within this time limit of p minutes, right? So this is the way you are thinking of binary search over here. I hope it is clear. Okay. So now, once you have found the time, you just return this from this function. So we can do this. If this answer, we can return it from this function. This function will return the number of balloons for one person, the optimal number of balloons or the maximum balloons he can fill in the particular time. So once we have found this, the number of balloons he can fill, what we can do, we can add it up to count. Count plus equal to num. Okay. And okay, let me take here a different variable. Let us say this is the count and this is num. And let us do num plus equal to count, because we had taken the number num here. We have taken this. Okay. So now one thing is, like, this will be, I think it should be fine to find the answer. So it should find the answer correctly. Let us see. Okay, so let me see out the value of answer. See out answer. So let us see. Yes, answer does, this one is correct. But we also need to print for each assistant how many balloons he are filling. So let us now basically we have solved the question. We have found how much time it is required. But the last part it says, for each assistant, just also find how many balloons each assistant is inflating or filling. So let us now build that array. So let us take an array or vector. You can say vector int, you can say it something like balloons. This will be containing the number of balloons filled by each assistant. So what we can do is, in this count function only, we can do one thing. Like, if this number actually is greater than or equal to m, so you can note one thing, like in this question we need to fill exactly m balloons. So if it is great, if you are able to fill more than m balloons, we need to reduce the number of balloons. So we need to actually fill only exactly m balloons. So what we can do is, num minus m, this difference we find out. So let us say this difference is some diff, and what we will do is, we will actually not fill this difference of balloons. We will make num equal to exactly m, because we do not need to fill more than m balloons. If you fill more than m balloons, it will give wrong answer. Okay, we need to fill exactly m balloons, not more than it and not less than it. So if we will find this difference, and what we can do is, this difference is which we will subtract it from, like, okay, num equals to m we have done, and we will subtract it from this count this person is filling, count minus diff. So basically, we are just preventing him to fill more extra balloons. This is the thing we are doing. And then we will push back you can say, let us take another vector here. Let us say vector int, some temporary vector temp, and we will push this this thing here, temp dot push back the number of balloons this person is filling. So it is cnt. So in this way, this loop will run for all the n persons, and it will fill all the values. But one thing is, suppose you have already found the answer, and if your num is exactly equal to m, so you do not need to do anything. You just push zero, because that, if you have found the answer, if you have filled all the m balloons, this num actually is containing the number of balloons filled. So if this number of balloons filled is equal to m, then why you need to fill more balloons? Why to fill that? Just avoid that. So just push back zero and continue. Continue means move to the next iteration of the loop, like this. So if you do like this, then you will be able to track that each person is filling how many balloons, like this. So it will be in the temp array. But why I have taken a different array temp or different vector temp, because it may be possible that this is not the final answer. Basically, this while low less than equal to high loop, this binary search loop will run multiple times. So every time we need to calculate this value, and we need to store only the final answer in the balloons value in the final vector. So we will, if this is a possible answer, if this number is this, if this number of balloons is greater than or equal to m, then only we will store the answer. We will do balloons equal to 10. Balloons equal to 10. We will store this vector in our answer only in that case, whenever we are able to fill those all m balloons. Fine. Now let us do one thing. Let us print all the elements of this vector. So for int I equal to 0, I less than temp dot size. You can also use auto loop, but if you don't know that, I am writing for just simple like this. Cout temp I, and there is a space between the elements. It is balloons. Temp is because, one more thing, if you do not know about the scope of variable, then since I have declared this temp inside this while loop, so it will get destroyed once it reaches the end of the loop. So the variables you declare inside a loop will remain inside that loop only. So it will be dead outside that. So I have declared this vector inside this while loop. So I cannot use it outside this while loop. Remember always. So I will use, basically I need to use this balloons array. So I will use this one, balloons. So yeah, it is giving the correct answer for this one. And let us try to submit it over code forces. So let me submit. So it is D part, children holiday. Yeah, it is accepted. So just by this question, you might have learned that in sometimes in questions, you may face some such a things that you need to use binary search two times. Inside the binary search also, you applied binary search in this question. So this is the, you can say, a type of question which you may face. So apart from this, if you have any doubt, you can ask. And I would say we just try to practice the remaining questions which you gave in the earlier session. We are not going more problems this class, but the problems which we have given in the earlier class, just try to solve them all. Like one good question is you should solve is spodge agar cow. We have given aggressive cows. So just try to solve this problem also, and all the remaining problems or whatever we have given in the practice. Spodge pie. One good problem this you should also solve. Spodge knotted tree. Spodge knotted tree. So these are some of the good problems. Like we wanted to discuss them also, but the time is less. Like we need to cover more topics also. So maybe it is not possible. Like if you face difficulty, then we may discuss in the next class. But just try to solve them by your own. So you should be able to solve. So these are like good questions on binary search. Apart from the ones, we have also given these in the previous doc. If you see the doc link of the previous class, these are questions you will find there, the link to them. So just try to solve these all. And also the practice questions, which whatever we have given. So it will really help. Because binary search, the thing is ki always whenever you are solving a question, you need to think it. It may be solved it using binary search or not. You need to think like this. Otherwise, you will not be able to get whether the question is of binary search or not. So always try to think of this. Ki it can be solved using that way or not. And apart from this, let me see if you have any doubts. The complexity, let us calculate the time complexity here. So it is something like log of 10 to the power 8 for this binary search multiplied by n, because for each n we are running something, and this inside this for loop the time complexity is O of log m again, of log 10 to the power 8 again. So let me write in formally like this. So the time complexity would be 10 to the power 8 is the maximum value of you can say time complexity is O of log of 10 to the power 8, right? Because the binary search is a time complexity of log of whatever the difference is between low and high, log of that difference or log of the search space, high minus low, it is 10 to the power 8 here. it multiplied by inside the binary search what you are doing. So in this binary search, we are running a for loop from I equal to 0 to n. So it will run n times, right? So into n, n multiplied by, again, in for each n, for each of these n values, you are running this get values function. And what is it? It is again a binary search of a time complexity of log of 10 to the power 8. So it will be, the time complexity would be something like this. Log of 10 to the power 8 square multiplied by n. This is the time complexity. So I hope it is clear. So yeah, it is very important to calculate time complexity so that you can find out whether it should give TLE or not. So I hope it is clear. Rest, binary search is a very important topic. You should try to solve. You should attempt the problems, practice problems given. Rest we will cover in tomorrow's session, which should be in the evening. We are planning to conduct in afternoon 2 p.m. or 1 p.m. So we will tell you the time. And if you have any preference of, like, if you have any lab exam or something, then please mention, like, try to mention it before, at least before 11:30, so that we can finalize the time. So anyways, let us quit it if you do not have any doubt. So bye everyone. And if you learn something new, then you may like the video and subscribe the channel if you're not done yet, so that you may get the, for subscribing, you will get the notification in future whenever we will conducting more streams. Interest. Goodbye, everyone.